and most of you know me, but I'm Lisa Jackson, the Massachusetts Region 4A Medical Reserve Corps Coordinator. And I'm talking about personal and community preparedness. I brought a bunch of handouts, as you see laid out there, and you can actually go onto the rady.gov site and order these, and they'll mail them, ship them free to your house. So if you have any schools or your workplace or your neighborhood or anything that you want to send out any of this information, it's part of a grant process that FEMA went through for preparedness, but it's free to the public, so please take advantage of it. And it's even Braille. I brought a Braille personal preparedness plan, so all those resources are available. They're your tax dollars at work, so use them. And I don't need to say, the better prepared your community is, the better your whole community will recover from a disaster. So how do you describe your current level of preparedness? You know, do you consider yourself well prepared for emergencies? Hands, yeah? I would hope so with your activity in CERT and MRC. I've gathered enough supplies and have thought about emergency plans for myself and my family. You guys in good shape with that? So, and that's one thing after this presentation, I'm gonna give you guys homework, and I'd like you guys to set a date where you actually check your kit if you already have one. And also, if you don't have one, prepare a kit and prepare a family preparedness plan. And then set up an anniversary date where you go over the plan with your family and you go over your supplies with your family, and then you look at your community where you would evacuate to and where your shelters are. So I'll talk about that at the end, but I'm preparing you early so you'll have homework. disasters, preparing for a disaster is important, but I haven't really started. That's what a lot of people say. You know, it's funny, I started this job 7 years ago. I grew up in Idaho, and, you know, preparedness, you know, like you live out in the middle of nowhere, you have plenty of food, you have all the stuff you need, but, you know, I hadn't really, you know, I had it all in my basement, but when I went down and actually pulled a kit together and put it in a bag and everything was ready to go, I had all this stuff, but if you have to evacuate your house, you may have all this stuff, but you may not have time to gather all this stuff together. So it, in a way, it gives you peace of mind. If you get that stuff together and you have it ready to go and you have a kit in your car, you have a kit at your office, and you talk to your children about how, and your family members, how they're going to be prepared. It just gives you a peace of mind. It seems like overkill, but unfortunately, lately, we've had a lot of incidences where we've had, you know, minor disasters around, so it's given us a little bit more to think about. I don't know how to prepare, but hopefully after this presentation, and some people, of course, don't have emergency plans in place. And I should talk about that a little. We live in a just-in-time society. You can go to CVS 24 hours a day. You can go to Stop and Shop 24 hours a day. That you can get gas almost every time. When the power goes down, that's gone. You know what I mean? So it's really, it behooves you to have all your things in place so you can take care of yourself. The last storm, October storm, in fact, I lost power myself for 6 days. I have a generator and I have enough food to feed a small army, so I was fine. But I didn't leave my house because I was working on deployment, setting up shelters and things like that. But I felt pretty comfortable. I'm like, okay, I have everything in place, and, you know, I was in a good place, you know. I was like, all right, I can stay here with my daughter, my family, my animals are safe, everything's good. Luckily, I didn't have to evacuate. So, a lot of barriers. I don't like to think about it. I can't afford the supplies now, no time. I don't live in an area where disasters will happen, you know. None of us do. And it's not my responsibility. And that's a mistake. A lot of people, I should talk about the responsibility. They have an expectation that, you know, local government, state government, federal government is going to take care of things. And you've got to remember, they have to mobilize their resources. So in a disaster, I mean, as well-doing as all of us are, we may not be able to take care of you. So we like to tell people in the first 48 hours, you're kind of on your own. You need to take care of yourself, you know. So, you know, I know you don't, some people don't think it's your responsibility. I'm preaching to the choir right now, but I'm doing it for the tape as well. But you know, it is your responsibility to take care of yourself, and it is your responsibility to make sure your family's prepared. And please, I urge you to talk to your family members about preparedness, because most people get busy with their day-to-day lives and they don't think about how important it is. Okay, emergencies, because emergencies happen, the best way to protect your family is to plan for the unexpected. Tornadoes. Dare I say that? You know, no one thinks it happens in Massachusetts, and here all of June we had last year a shelter set up out in western Massachusetts. So, you know, occurrence of natural or man-made disasters is a reality, and it can happen without warning. I called Heidi today because my email server, I don't know if any of you have Comcast, my email was down for about 3 hours, and I felt lost. You know, just that little thing, and that was like a little personal disaster, but it wasn't my email, it was actually a lot of people in my area. But, you know, just something like that, it's amazing how quickly you lose, you know, I'm so tied to the computer and email, how quickly I felt out of the loop. So did you know that major disasters may not receive emergency services right away? Like I said, most cases it's 48 hours. A lot of your government, your employees that live in town may not live in town. Disasters like to happen on a Friday night. You know, I'm getting all psyched for the weekend, and sure enough, I'm on call and, you know, on standby, and I'm like, oh man, you know. So, you know, you got to understand that, you know, you got to take care of yourselves, and certainly if you're able, it's very important that you take care of yourself. And, you know, take care of your neighbors as well. Here's some pictures of disasters. That's a very large-scale shelter. Of course, flooding, that happens here, you know. Tornadoes, all of those things, you know. It's a reality, and you could very quickly find yourself in that situation. You don't want to think about it, but, you know, I think about those giant trees I have around my house when those windstorms come through, and I'm like, you know, all it takes is one of those down and I'm out of the house, you know. So even the most prepared person is not immune to it. So what disasters are most likely to happen in your community? And I know we've talked about that with some of our other trainings, but you need to know, you know, whether you're in a flood zone. Do you have any, like I have an LNG facility in Hopkinton. You know, Heidi and I talked about a gas station that could be at risk in Bedford. Just know about what potential disasters could happen in your community. You have a lot of trees. You know, right there, you know, that's presented a lot of problems lately. So how will you be warned? And I should probably turn that over to you guys. How does Bedford warn their citizens? You have CTY Connect or Code Red? Yep.
Radio station.
And you might use the banners, the police signs with things like that. And sometimes you may have to go door to door, I mean, as a volunteer. To check on people, and sometimes that happens. We've done that in some of our other communities. So when everything goes down, phone lines, cable, you know, power, you know, very quickly that infrastructure that we're so dependent on goes away. So you really want to think about how you're going to find out what to do to take care of yourself and your family. You know, how do you prepare for different types of disasters? You know, I mean, for a tornado, you prepare differently than an ice storm. You know, there's certain things you want to know, and we'll talk a little bit more about that, but think about it. You know, just really kind of put your self in that place. You know, severe weather, natural disaster, severe thunderstorms. You know, I laugh, I have a piece of furniture that was my great-grandmother's that was hit by lightning through her window. You know what I mean, in California. So, and her house caught on fire, and that was the one piece of furniture they got out of the house. So it's been handed down a few generations. But, you know, you think about that, just a thunderstorm. I mean, you could be pushed out of your house. Tornadoes, winter storms. The temperature outside makes a huge difference, okay? So Hurricane Irene, it was 8 degrees out. You could sleep in your backyard, you could hang out in your house, everything was fine. But the October storm, starting out, it was pretty, you know, it was in the 20s, but it kind of got up to 40. So most people, is kind of tolerable staying in their homes. The ice storm of 2008, which didn't touch us in this area, it was out in the western part of the area, it was going below zero, you know, and power was out, and was out for 12 days. So pipes froze, So people were evacuating their houses for different reasons than an initial damage of the storm. Excessive heat, I don't know about you, I mean, this feels hot to me. You know what I mean? So, when it gets up to the 90s, 100s, particularly the elderly population, they're at risk, and people that have underlying health problems, excessive heat is a risk factor as well. Of course, man-made disasters and terrorist attacks, we don't like to think about them, but, they do happen. So, make a disaster kit. Set up a phone contact list. How many of you know what your family members' phone numbers are? By hand. I know a few, but it's kind of funny. I used to memorize everything, and cell phones and computers have made us very, very lazy. So have a printout. You can go into Outlook and you can print out all your contacts and you have it on a piece of paper. You know what I mean? So that's kind of an easy thing to do. Particularly as the MRC insert, know who you're going to have to contact in a disaster to help out. Make a plan. I mean, I'm beating a dead horse here, but make your plan. Make sure it works. Figure out how to evacuate out of the house. My daughter loves when I throw the ladder out of the second floor window and we get to climb out the ladder out of the bathroom window. So, just make a plan. Make it fun for your kids and, your family and figure out where you're going to evacuate, where you're going to meet if you leave your house, and where you can meet outside of the town. Like Hopkinton has an LNG facility, we might not be able to stay in Hopkinton. So think about a few places. And again, test your plan. If you haven't already set up a plan, set up an anniversary date. Today's a good day. Next year at this time, if you already have a plan in place, or tomorrow or the next time this weekend when you drill your plan, put it on your Outlook calendar, put it in your regular calendar that you do it every year. And then you go through your kit, you take all the old items out of your kit, put the new items in, rotate it out, make sure the batteries work, and you do a quick drill. It doesn't take that much time. And again, it's like insurance for your car. It's peace of mind. So, 3 days of supplies for each family member. That's kind of what you want to plan around if you shelter in place. And even if you go to a shelter, it takes us a little while to get resources there. So it's kind of nice when you have your power bars and you have some water ready, if you're waiting for stuff. Develop a family communications plan. My daughter's 8 years old, and she has my phone number memorized, my mom's phone number memorized, her dad's phone number memorized. So, she doesn't have a cell phone yet, but at least she can get to somebody and say, I need to call my parents. But, you need to have a communication plan that's appropriate for the people that are within your family. And if you have elders that don't have a cell phone or don't use it very often or just dial the number still, they should have a printout. Be informed. Stay informed about all types of disasters. I hate watching the news. I really feel like it's tabloid now, but you have to watch it to know what's going on, what the weather's going to do. I'm kind of always watching it just to be prepared myself. So again, to get a kit, 3 days of food and water. Power bars are awesome. You don't need to go nuts, but canned goods, of course, beef jerky, things like that. They're not perishable. Water, you want to rotate that. A weather radio. You can buy them at Walmart or, any Kmart. I think even CVS sells them. It's a radio that connects to the National Weather Service. They sell hand crank ones. They're about $10. And that's, if all else fails, you can get, for $10, you can have a radio that'll at least tell you what's going on if everything else is down. Prescriptions and over-the-counter medicines. You want to make sure that you have those in place. And, with the insurance companies, you get exactly 30 days supply. And if you plan a little ahead in advance, you can save that extra day. So refill your prescription on the 30th day and get that few extra, especially if you have cardiac meds or things that you need to take every day. So plan for that. Personal hygiene items. We've set up shelters. We try to make sure we have soap. In fact, we're purchasing some from the region. But we may not have some of those things. So bring the things. It's like your to-go bag when you go away for the weekend. Have those things ready to go. Change of clothes, a pair of boots. Don't be running off to a shelter in high heels. You know what I mean? Because you never know. Just be appropriate, and think things ahead. So a pandemic influenza, most likely you're going to be at home if we talk about a pandemic. And, you know, we had H1N1, we dodged a bullet with that. But if they decide to isolate everybody and keep everybody home and not go to school and not go to big workplaces, you want to have 2 to 4 weeks of food supply and water if possible. So you want to think about that. Again, the weather radio, that's another way to get information across. It is amazing how quickly resources would drop down if 40% of our population was out of the loop. Think of all the trucks that go around every day, all the trains, those people that drive it, the people that run the stores, that take care of the power plants, all that stuff. When a pandemic happens, that workforce gets depleted. So, you know, just be prepared. Again, the prescriptions over the counter, medications, and personal hygiene items, because they'll go away. I don't know if you participate in this, but MITRE Corporation did a study. And we have an applet that they did on most of Region 4A and part of Region 3 on what would happen during a pandemic. And they actually routed how quickly, with 40% of the population sick or taking care of someone that's sick, how quickly, you know, there wouldn't be water, there wouldn't be food, there wouldn't be gasoline. And they anticipated it to be about 3 days that our services would be out just with that depletion. So, you know, keep your eyes and ears open. You know, we have a pretty good idea when a pandemic's coming. Heidi, do you want to talk about that? Actually, our region purchased these. These are an emergency info kit. It's a file for life, and Heidi's done a great push in Bedford to get this information out. But if you have somebody that's, you know, has special needs in their home, and even yourself, it's good to have this in your home. So. Yeah, that from the health department, she has a whole bunch of them. So, and you may ask your volunteers to pass them out too, if that might be an option. But this is a great way, you know, if emergency responders come in the home or you need to leave, here's all your information. You take it with you and you have it ready to go.
Yes, they're in process right now. They were online. We're updating them now. So yep. They will be available to be updated. As Lisa said, it's important if your information changes, your prescriptions change. Right.
Absolutely.
And take it with you if you go to a shelter.
Absolutely. And to think about that on what you put in there, you want to have your insurance policies, you know, your health insurance, your homeowner's insurance, a copy of your important items. Those are all things that are also important to take with you as well, because once that documentation goes, it is very, very hard to replace, and you become nobody if you don't have it. So, and that's a perfect example at the Springfield shelter. A lot of the folks out there were Bhutanese, Nepalese, and from the Islamic community, and they lost all their documentation. That's part of why that shelter was open for a whole month. So it was, you know, different. You know, it made a problem, you know. Use the attached document to prepare for family preparedness supplies. Ready.gov, I gave you guys a bunch of stuff. This is on our website. Use whichever one you think works best for you and your family. Heidi's actually is way more comprehensive than this. But, you know, use a guide that works for you. They're out there. All you have to do is say, get ready, or, you know, preparedness, and a gazillion things will pop up. So again, I was going to talk about, make copies of your important documents and IDs, your Social Security card, your birth certificates, your insurance policies, your financial information, all of those things you need copies of. I laminated mine, you know, and put them in a place where I could get them, you know what I mean? So it's something, and that's part of my annual review. If I change my auto insurance or whatever, I change that in my kit. Because if you don't have it, you're not going to remember it. And everything's so electronic nowadays. And if paper's gone, your electronic stuff is gone, you don't have a whole lot, you know. Contact information, always important. And that's part of why you do this annually or biannually. Everybody changes their email address or their work phone or anything like that. So, you know, keep all that stuff up to date. So you make sure that you have it. And it's all, you know, it's all in these lists, too. Water, non-perishable food, you know, the water's good for about a year. You go down, when you replace it, just use it in your household and replace it. Power bars, beef jerky, I think it'll last forever. You know, there's things that you can buy that are non-perishable that'll last a long time. A first aid kit, again, medications, prescription, non-prescription. First aid kit, people don't think about burn cream, and I always talk about that in a disaster. Burn cream is very important because a lot of times when there's a disaster, even in the winter, you could have a fire in the house, and it's something very simple to have in your kit, and it's not always listed on the kits. Flashlight, radio, and extra batteries, that's the same thing you rotate out of your kit every year. You check your flashlight, make sure the batteries are good, but just rotate them out so you don't have to worry about it. Cash, that's huge, because I'm sure you notice when the power goes out, no stores are open. They don't want to deal with it. It's a security issue, but if you really need something, you know, as things move along, cash, I pretty much don't use cash for anything except for to pay the babysitter once in a while. But you know what I mean? Most of us are in that boat. So you want to have a good amount of cash. I keep a couple $100s on me, which is not very much money, but at all times, just in case, you know. Keys, of course, you want to have spare keys, things like that. You want to be able to get in your property if you need to, or in your safety deposit box. Again, personal hygiene items, special items, baby items, and pet food. I'll brush on pet preparedness a little bit, but it's really important to have the dog food or cat food that the animal eats if you take them to a shelter. So I just take it and tape it to the top of the carrier with duct tape, and it's ready to go. Clothes and a pair of boots, and you know, any things, you know, again, it's always a good idea. I have a kit in my vehicle, but just have it in all the places. The kit's a little smaller in your vehicle, but even if you break down or you get a flat tire or something like that, you'll have things you'll need. I'm always hungry, so it's always good to have food anyway. So, you know, again, the water supply, we'll go into that a little bit more detail. Clean, you can put in a plastic container. Actually, at Walmart, you can get those containers that are collapsible and things like that, that are pretty cheap, fiberglass, enamel lined containers. Seal the container tightly and store in a cool, dark place. I always get the iodine tablets. They're a good backup to have, and you can buy them at any outdoor store, but it can decontaminate water. So if you do need water, it's a tiny little bottle that big, and if you run out of water or you have access to water but it's not necessarily clean, you can throw the iodine tablets in there and take care of it. Again, 72 hours is a good idea. Keep the gas tank the gas tank half full or full. Yeah, I push to a third and a quarter, but I still try to do that, and luckily my car thinks for me and tells me when it's when it's running out of gas. But you know, that's something to think about, you know, and particularly if a storm's coming through, just fill up your gas tank. You know, there might be a little line at the gas station and everybody's thinking about it, but just do it, you know. You know, store it in a convenient place where all your family members know where it is, and that'd be part of your disaster plan and your drill that you do every year. You show everybody where it is, in the car or in the basement, and you know, at work, if you have one at work. Keep things in airtight plastic bags. I put them in Ziploc bags, or laminate a lot of this stuff, but I put it in Ziploc bags, and you can put it in a bin. I have a big tote bag, and then I have one of those Rubbermaid bins, and then I put everything in a Ziploc bag, because if you keep it in your basement or in your garage, critters can get in there, and just, you don't want to go in there and find some mouse has made a nest in your kit, you know? And again, it says, you know, change your water every 6 months and your food every 6 months. You can do it a year, but, you know, you can decide what you think about that. Rethink your kit and your family needs every year. The first year I made the kit, my daughter was 2.5. She's 8. So, you know, that's a stark difference of what you use for a 2.5-year-old to an 8-year-old. So, you know, rethink of what you would put in your kit. And you may have, your animal situation may change. You know, a lot of stuff may change. That's why it's important to do this annually or biannually. Replace batteries, update clothes. Maybe you gained weight over Christmas, or you lost weight, or, you know, it would be a bummer to get to a shelter and your extra pair of pants are too tight or too big. So, you know, just update it with stuff you would like to wear. Ask your doctor about storing medication. Some people are diabetics, things like that. We can generally, in a shelter and things like that, and I have to remind you, we've only had really small disasters in Massachusetts lately. So we can get access to medication. It takes a little while, but talk to your doctor about the best way to store it and your specific needs for your prescription medication. to make sure it's safe, because you don't want to store it and then it's not valid anymore and it's not useful. So just have the discussion with your doctor at your next visit. So building one for your car, it's a little bit smaller, flashlight, battery operated radio, more batteries, a whistle, a dust mask, a pocket knife, water, snacks, manual can opener. Nobody thinks about that because, you know, everything's electric, but if you have a can, if you don't have a manual can opener, yeah, they're hard to get into, you know. So think about the little cheap ones you get for $2 and you put it in there. A blanket, a sleeping bag, you know, all the shelters we've set up, you know, a lot of times civil defense or whoever sets up the shelters, and you have these itchy wool blankets, and you know, it's just much nicer if you have your own blankets, your own pillow, that stuff, if you do even end up at a shelter. Clothing, again, copies of important papers, driver's license, and a cell phone charger. That's huge. Some of our kits, we have a hand crank charger, which was really cool. They can charge anything that you could press into an outlet. They're a little expensive. They're like $50. You can get power inverters for your car. So that's another way to get power. So there's a lot of ways that, because quickly you lose communication with everybody when your cell phone's not working anymore. So make sure my Corvette actually has a lighter thing, but it doesn't work. It's all rusted out. So I have to get that fixed so it doesn't work with my car. So again, a winter car kit, a shovel, a windshield scraper, battery-powered radio, flashlight, distress flag, mittens, hat, blanket, tow chain and rope, and a bag of road salt and sand. Again, I grew up in Idaho, so this is kind of a no-brainer for this stuff to be in my car, but you know, it's good to have it. You know, AAA might get a little busy and you might be stuck out there for a while. Why not help yourself, you know? So again, make a plan. Develop a family communications plan like we talked about. Who do you call, when, where, how is everybody going to connect with everybody? A shelter-in-place plan. A lot of times you end up sheltering in place, so that's important. Make an evacuation plan. Everybody thinks their home is so safe. Like I said, my big giant trees, if they come down as safe as I think my home is, I'm out of there. You know what I mean? I have to get out of there. And know your emergency plans at work and school, and don't be afraid to ask. Ask your employer, you know, where's the evacuation route in your business? Ask those questions. And if they haven't done it, I've worked here for 10 years and we've never had a drill, an evacuation drill. I mean, that's why I brought the business plans. Ask your people that you work with. I mean, you may be thinking about it because you're obviously engaged in this type of this work, but, you know, talk to your boss about it. Talk to your coworkers about it, because think about in Newton when that fire happened, and this was probably, I would say, 97, 98, and I was working for the visiting nurses, and I remember driving by seeing people's heads, and a bunch of people died because they couldn't get out of that building. And it was like a three-decker. You know, we're not talking about a big building. So, you know, it's very important to know those plans. Again, there's the attached document, but you can use the ones I passed out. Again, decide where to meet in the event of emergency. Identify three locations. The first location obviously should be home. Second location should be at a relative or a friend nearby. Third location, out of the immediate area. So you want to think of those three places of where, because you may not be able to get to your house. My house on October 3rd, there was a giant tree that came down in the middle of the road. My road was shut down. And there were live wires across the street. And I live on a little dinky scenic road. So, you know, it was across my neighbor's driveway, thank God, not mine, or, you know, whatever. But it's still, you know, you need to think about that. The second location, again, you know, in the town or a little bit outside of the town, a relative or a friend nearby. And again, the third location, 20, 30 miles, 40, 50 miles away from the immediate area. All right. Practice and train on what to do in an emergency. Know how to get the information. Know how to connect with each other. Do a quick communication plan. You can do a texting drill, especially if you have teenage kids or little older kids. Even my daughter knows how to text. You can text each other, find out where you are, and just pretend that you're going to have to meet someplace. Teenagers actually love it. You wouldn't think they would, but they like it. And, you know, ensure that you and your family will act automatically when the event threatens you. Don't be like the most calm person in the world. When a disaster happens, they may not be calm, and they may not act rationally. So, you know, make sure you talk to your family about it, go through the drill so they know what to do in the disaster. So communication barriers, I've talked a little bit about that. Landlines down, cell phone lines overwhelmed, or cell towers down. That happened out in the ice storm. The cell towers were down all over the place. Power outages, have a corded phone in your house. Everybody has cordless phones. If there is phone lines working and the power's out and you have a corded phone, that'll work, but your cordless phones won't work. Internet's inaccessible. I had a little touch of that today. I'm like, oh my God, all the disasters I've been through, and I hadn't had that happen. But I have an air card, you know what I mean? I have a few ways on how to access the internet, but if that goes down, even me, I feel a little sketchy about that. So that's something to think about. You know, how are you going to communicate? How are you going to, you know, and again, that goes back to those meeting places. You know, sometimes have to do the old-fashioned way, you know. So, again, communication redundancies, have backup forms of communication, radios. I have radios in my house. I'm a ham radio. You know, there's a few ways. I have a cell phone, and I have the chargers and email, and you think about all the ways you personally can back it up, but just make sure you have a lot of stuff in place, because very quickly a few of those things go out of place and you're lost, you know. Again, have a communication plan in place. Use a third-party contact to let each other know you are safe. Sometimes if a certain area is affected, the phone lines get overburdened and the cell towers get overburdened. Sometimes you can call someone outside of that, get a hold of them, and say, please call my family members. My cell phone battery's about to die, or I'm having trouble getting through. Let them know I'm okay. So, your family may not be together in a disaster. We're sitting in the room. Are all our family members here with us? Even here, you know, every day, all of us are so busy, all over the place. You know, there's a high likelihood that you're not going to be with your family if a disaster happens, particularly if it's something that's very quick. If you're at work and your children are at school and your loved ones at home or at work, where will you meet? Where will you guys come together? You know, have a meeting point, you know, and it's kind of lost because we're so used to connecting, but it's so important to have that so you know how to find out how each other's safe. Again, talk to your family, make a plan now. Who will be the point of contact person? You know, again, you pick someone a little bit further away that might not be affected by the disaster. Will it be the person, like with me, I'm, you know, kind of the head of household, so people would contact me. So pick a person in the family who kind of organizes that with, and it'd probably be all of you, because you've taken the class, you know the stuff, and you have homework to do it. So how will you communicate? And how will you take care of your pets? I have chickens and horses. That's a little tough to think about. You know, I just throw all my hay in the paddock and, you know, throw all the feed in the coop if I had to evacuate, things like that. But I always have enough to last at least a few weeks. But think about that. Think ahead. How are you going to take care of them? So, you know, again, set up a phone contact list, local exchanges, carry copies of all your family numbers and your hospital numbers with you. My daughter has a little emergency plan on rady.gov. You can print out a family emergency contact list and put it in your kids' backpacks, in your pocket, at work, whatever, you know. Outside your area, when local phone circuits are busy, long distance calls may be easier to make. I have family in Idaho. It's kind of far away, but they may be able to contact a lot of people when I can't do it. And then cell phones and home phones, you know, pre-program the numbers and keep your mobile phone batteries charged. So make sure you have a way to do that. And those hand cranks are actually really good because you don't need anything to do it as long as the cell towers are up. So be informed. The all hazards radio, that's always up and running. Emergency alert systems, you've heard that annoying thing on TV that looks like it's 100 years old. When they come up, you'd think they make it a little flashier when they do the emergency test, but, you know, that's something that might come up. An outdoor warning system. In Bedford, do you have, like, a siren that goes off at noon? No, because, well, in Ashland we do. Yeah, because in between Hopkinton and Ashland, I can hear when I'm like, oh, it's lunchtime. So, you know, it's the emergency, they practice it every, you know, so if you may still have that active if you need it, you know, but you don't do it every day, like, our old country towns, you know, where we are. TV broadcasts, I should warn you a little bit about that. The news tends to not be quite aware of what exactly is going on. So just kind of keep that in mind. But, you know, when the governor talks or someone from FEMA or a town official or fire chief talks, listen to them. They'll know what they're talking about, hopefully. Highway messaging, like the billboard signs and the traffic, that's a good way. And protective action, shelter in place or evacuate. Those are two things. I look at the Cape, and that seems like a colossal nightmare to every time I drive out there. I'm like, you know, this would be a little tough to get out of here if we needed to, you know. So maybe sheltering in place would be a better way to go. Again, storing family documents, emergency money, pets. Is your emergency kit portable? Mine weighs, I think, about 75, 80 pounds. I have no problem picking it up. I'm moving hay and stuff all the time, but I remember I went in to do a presentation for one of our towns, and one of our health directors, who will remain nameless, went to try to pick it up, and he's like, oh my God, you know, so make sure it's portable. I actually did this presentation in Framingham, and this lady had 8 kids, and she's like, I'm going to take the kit and break it up into 8 little backpacks so everybody can carry their load, and it was really portable. So, you know, think about that. You know, it's interesting talking about where to store the important family documents. We're always trying to guard our identity. Just think about where you put it pretty thoughtfully. Make it accessible, but not too accessible. So someone, you know, if they get a hold of it, it's not a good thing. So yeah, I mean, it's a tough thing. You know, you need to have it and you want to have it available, but I stuff it in the bottom of my emergency kit. So, you know, if someone's rummaging through a bag and sees a bunch of food and clothes and books, I would hope they wouldn't get all the way down to the bottom of the bag and say, oh, woohoo, you know. So, you know, just think about where you put it, you know what I mean, and where it's accessible. Sheltering planning, you know, again, not all shelters are for people with special needs. And that's or pets, and that's something we've come up with again and again. What do you do? I mean, you have someone coming to your shelter, and Heidi and I had this discussion in the October storm. You have them come there, and you're not supposed to turn anybody away, but you don't have the ability to take care of them appropriately. So usually they're calling someone like me, or we're scrambling to trying to find another place where they are. So think about your personal needs and your family's personal needs, and kind of save yourself some pushing around. And if there are identified special needs shelters, Mass 211 is a great way to access that information. Just dial Mass 211 and you can ask them. And they say, you know, my family member has special needs, you know, they're not ambulatory, they're in a wheelchair. Where can I send them, you know, and then they can give you a list of what those shelters are. Like I said, identify the shelters in your area and what they can accommodate and what they can handle. The government, local government, is very well intended to meet all the needs, but sometimes they just don't have the resources to do it. And people get mad or whatever, but, you know, it is what it is. So in a disaster, you take best care of your family and figure out the best way to do that. And again, 211 is an available resource for local shelters. And I don't know if I should say this out loud, but I was using 211 because it had faster information than MEMA did sometimes. So, you know. Sometimes there's a little disconnect there, but Mass 211 is an absolutely incredible resource. I use it during a disaster, and I'm in knee deep with everything. So know all the exit routes out of your home and neighborhood. Think about it. You know, all these little windy streets. Just think about a few ways. You know, and actually strategizing around how to get around traffic is a good way to find out, you know, how to get some way fast that you wouldn't go normally. Account for your family members with special needs and for your pets. Just think about how you'll get them out of there. I have a horse trailer. All my horses will fit in if I need to get them out of there, and I'd stuff all the chickens in the front of it and whatever. Yeah, you know, maybe. But, you know, so that's something, you know, think about that, how you're going to evacuate those your family. So when you evacuate, you want to think, are you in immediate danger? People sometimes overreact to that. Again, that's why to have that information very important. Are you directed to by an emergency official? Some people get, oh, this guy's falling, you know, I got to get out of here. But maybe they're perfectly safe where they are. So that's something to think about. It. Don't react immediately. Just take some time to assess. If you don't see something before your eyes that you're in immediate danger, take a few steps back and really educate yourself and really learn where you need to go. Again, stay tuned to your local radio or TV station for emergency information. Take your disaster kit if needed. If you evacuate your house, just take it. You know, it's peace of mind, it's insurance, you have it with you. Follow your area disaster plan for transportation options and evacuation routes. Do you guys have a labeled evacuation route in Bedford? Yeah. No, in not all communities, you don't have a nuclear power plant or LNG facility or anything like that. You don't have, I mean, you have a few major highways that go through here, but, you know, your risk is relatively low. But, you know, just know how to get out of there and just kind of know how to get to the main routes. Usually those are open first if there's a major disaster. What'd you say?
Not the great road.
Yeah. No, I know. I've driven on it. Yeah, it's a little tough, you know. Right.
You know, if that's your main route away from your home,
exactly.
you need to have an alternative. Right. Thinking about that. That's
my little road in Hopkinton Cross Street that I live on, it floods. I mean, because it's just, it's got this little culvert and it just floods. So that road I know is not going to work during flooding. So just think about that. Look at your topography. Look where you live and just assess that. You know, again, take your disaster kit. First, seek shelter with friends and family outside the affected area. That's best case scenario. If you have to evacuate, I would rather stay at my friend's house than a shelter. You know, and if you have that option, take advantage of it, because really the shelters are there for people who don't have those resources. Again, disaster shelters will be open, providing basic food and water. Again, know where your local shelter is, and it's right up the street here, isn't it, at the school? Yeah. So, you know, where is it? It's
town center.
Oh, it's, yes, yeah, it's, but you have a second one in the school? Yeah, so one and two, yeah. But, you know where it is, and get that information out to your community so they know. Again, make a plan for your pet. Most shelters don't allow pets. As I was driving in, I saw that there is Animal Hospital. Is that in Bedford? It's in Lexington, but maybe you talk to them. Sometimes the town will have an MOU with them where you can figure out a way, or your friends will take them. You know, I mean, maybe your friends can take your pets that have power. Learn shelter in place. When you're instructed to shelter in place by emergency officials, stay tuned to the radio or TV for info and use your disaster kit as needed. Don't get all antsy and want to go out and drive and look around. Everybody likes doing that during a disaster. It's like, get off the roads, you know. So, you know, stay at home if you can and if you have all the stuff. What to do in a power outage, utility and water shut off. That's important to know. Do you know how to shut that off in your house? You know, I do. But if you don't, figure it out, you know, talk to someone, talk to an electrician or find out how to shut it off. Locate your electric, gas, and water meters and use colored tape to identify cutoff valves. So when you know, I lived in an apartment and I don't have natural gas now, but natural gas is a little sketchy in a disaster, so you want to be able to shut it off. Smoke and carbon monoxide detectors, have them battery operated as well as hardwired. I mean, that's pretty much mandatory, but just make sure it works and make sure they're working. And then if you need to get out, you get out, you evacuate. Carbon monoxide poisoning. This happened quite a bit in the last storms that we had. People ran their generators. People had them next to their house. And some people even ran them in their house, and a few people died in the October storm. They didn't handle it properly. So if you have a generator, you know, you got to handle it properly. Know how to use it. And if you don't, you know, learn how to use it. Just, it's your responsibility. You know, you got to take care of yourself. Again, install the smoke detectors. Move beds away from windows. Clear hallways and exits for easy evacuation. Keep an ABC type fire extinguisher and know how to use it. I have it right in my kitchen. Thank God I haven't had to use it. I cook a lot. But, you know, just have that and know how to use it and replace it. I just replaced it because it was getting old. It just has, it's got three ways that you do it. So it's like boom, boom, boom. Yeah. You could probably, mine has like a handle.
Most ABC, so you wouldn't have a water.
Yeah.
It's all, it has it, but it's two.
Right.
Yes,
is that what it is? I thought it was because it was so easy to start. You pull the pin out and you go boom. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, ABC. It's easy as ABC. So, but yeah, you buy it. You can buy it at Home Depot. You can buy it at Lowe's, Walmart, all that stuff. Store flammable and highly reactive chemicals, bleach them only securely and separate from each other. So you want to do that anyway, so you don't have your own personal disaster. But you know, like me, I have a bunch of gas cans because of my generator if I lose power. So I try to make sure they're in a safe place and nothing's going to start them on fire. So secure hazards around your phone, outside furniture, shutters. That's a big thing when you have a violent storm that comes through. That stuff goes flying through windows. I always look at it on my deck. I have my umbrella out there. I pull that down and shove it under the deck and just make sure there's things that aren't going to go flying around. Only when instructed to do so. That actually happened in June, or actually June 1st when we had those tornadoes come through. The severe warning came out and you were supposed to get inside your house and stay away from the windows, you know, so.
I recently heard relative to the storms out west, the tornadoes out west that they were experiencing in the past couple months.
Yeah.
Relative to bike helmets, that they found that there were fewer head injuries with kids, and they didn't talk so much about adults, but kids that where they fastened the bike helmet.
That is wonderful. Nice. Data. But why wouldn't it makes perfect sense. Yeah. I mean, and I never even thought of that. I mean, I have helmets for horses, snowboarding. Well, yeah, I have a zillion.
They're typically around the house.
Right.
If you're going to be, you know, sheltering for an hour or two, why not?
Yeah, throw your helmet on. Yeah, and you can make fun of each other while you're bored. Wait. Yeah. So, you know, why not, you know? So, but yeah, so that, you know, I didn't know that. That makes perfect sense, though. You know, why wouldn't you? Yet again, test your plan. Hold emergency drills with the household members at least twice a year. My daughter loves it. She's 8 years old. She likes the whole little deal we do. Just make it fun. Bake cookies afterwards or whatever. Have pizza party or whatever. Make it fun so it's interesting. And you can make jokes about it. But it's, yeah, if you do it, you know how to do it. During the drills, test fire extinguishers, smoke detectors, batteries, and recharge and replace twice a year. Without batteries, a lot of, you know, it just doesn't work, you know, so make sure those are available. Show each family member how and when to turn off the utilities. I'm not sure I want my 8-year-old daughter doing that, but, you know, other adults that would be in my house, I would have them do that. But just, you know, make sure all the adults know how to shut off the switches. Check expiration dates and replace water and food supplies as needed in your kit. And that's part of your anniversary date, you know. So this is the information where you can get a lot of good resources. And again, the ready.gov and all those things. But do you have any questions? It's kind of a short and sweet presentation. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.